When you eliminate the improbable, the impossible, and the impractical, and the truth still stands. So, I personally have done the math, applied the logic, measured out the geometry, and then added reason, and I must tell you, the equation still comes out the same. And frankly, not only have my eyes deceived me. It is January 7, 2016 at 5:30 p.m. on the dot. And I am introducing to those new to the subject a major crusader of truth, Mark Sargent. Now he, along with Eric DeBay, Rob Skiba, to make noteworthy, are at the very forefront of the most explosive discussion, more like a concussion on the world today, that has the potential of literally turning the world as you know it upside down. Just to start with. Now, Mark Sargent is engaging, erudite, rapid in intelligence and understanding completely on this subject, but also, and noteworthy, is willing to back away from an untruth, recognize the deception, as well as being willing to ferret out reality wherever it exists. He has a great radio voice and presence. I feel honored to just speak with him, and to have him on my first broadcast session for YouTube is rather mind-blowing to me. I'm asking Mark to talk about what he wants to, say things beyond other interviews just to start with, and how the subject is changing the world. And the best way to introduce this subject is, I understand, by asking a question and not saying we're going to talk about this subject. So ask me a question, if you would, Mark, that might make me help you introduce the subject.
Sure. And by the way, thank you very much for having me. And I'm sorry if my my radio voice isn't 100% tonight. I just had an appendectomy.
Yes.
I had my appendix taken out a week ago. And so the tubes they jammed down my throat are still rubbing me a little wrong. But to your question, the question I put forth to everyone, including the entire internet, is how do you know you are where you think you are? Meaning, how do you know you live on a globe? And it seems like a fairly simple question.
Mm-hmm.
So when I put that to you, you would probably come back. And the question's kind of rhetorical for me, because everybody answers either one of two ways, without fail. The first way is, well, we're on a globe. Everybody knows that. It's a given, like gravity or water or fire. We know the globe has been in our classroom. I saw it when I was in first grade. It's a globe. And then I come back and I say, okay, other than the model that's been in the corner of your classroom for all those years, how else do you know? And then you come back and say, well, NASA told us. You know, NASA showed us the picture. I go, yeah. They showed you one picture. In fact, they only had one picture from 1972 until July of 2015. Mm-hmm. So if all your faith is being put in NASA, you know, is it well-founded? You know, you get a member. They're a military wing of the United States government founded on the still-burning embers of the Nazi war machine. And that's a lot of faith. And when you go back and look at them closely, there's a lot of things missing there that should be the given you're looking for. So I don't know if that's a good enough question to start, but that's usually what I lead with.
That is excellent and goodly. And what I find most fascinating is not just about the NASA, but also about the measurement of ships disappearing into the horizon, which it's not true. Back in the time of my ancestors, no one had a telescope. We do today. And so we set the telescope, and no, it has not disappeared anywhere.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, the high-end cameras, that's what the one bad thing about technology, if you're trying to control the world from an authority standpoint. So when I say authority, I mean usually three groups, the super rich, the royals, and the governments. And that is, the problem with technology is it's going to permeate into certain places, and there's no way you can stop it. So once computers got small enough that you could fit a full-blown PC into a phone, well, you could also put a full-blown PC into a camera, you know, on a high-end camera, and give cameras abilities they didn't have even 10 years ago, including super zoom, like with the Coolpix P900 or whatever that thing that came out with, just a monster zoom. And so basically, you go to the beach and you look out, and with just your naked eyes, you can see about 3 miles, and you see ships disappearing into the distance. You think they're going over the horizon, because that's what you've been told. But then you whip out your zoom camera or your phone or whatever you've got with super zoom capability, and you zoom in on this ship, and now it's there again. And it disappears because it's gone out of your range. Well, if you had a more powerful telescope, you'd be able to see that ship at a very, very long range, way further than you should be able to see it. And by that, and I know this is going to throw some people, nobody likes hearing math. I hated math in high school, and everybody else did too. That's why the nerds, there weren't that many of them. The chess club in my school, very small. Mm-hmm. And that was the curvature of the Earth, if you believe mainstream science. It's not what we talk about, the flat Earth people. Mainstream science says it's about 8 inches per mile squared, which means it is 8 inches times every mile times itself. So it's not like going down stairs where it's like 8 inches per mile forever. That's just a slope. You've got to adjust it for a curve. Mm-hmm. So at 2 miles, it's 2 times 2, which is 4, times 8 inches is 32. 3 times 3 is 9, times 8 is 72. And it just gets worse from there to the point where when you do like 50 miles, it's 50 times 50 times 8 inches, which is 1,680 feet, roughly. And that's a long way. You know, that's 1,680 feet, which means if you have an object 1,680 feet high, at 50 miles, you shouldn't be able to see it because it's on the other side of the curvature. It's on the other side of the hill that you're trying to look on, the other side of. But yet, the Chicago skyline, that's just one of many all around the world. You can see these things. And everyone says, well, it's mirage, it's not real. It's like, well, that's not necessarily true, because I've interviewed people that deal with high-end military technology that says they're painting targets at 60 miles and beyond that are way lower than 1,000 feet. They're barely even 100 feet off the water.
Exactly.
And so, yeah, even the curvature. So that's the second question that I throw at people, which is, where is the curvature of the Earth? Tell me, if you had to grab the average person off the street without any limit to money or time, how would you show them the curvature of the Earth? And they can't. Nobody can. Everybody keeps backing up the same. Well, you have to take a rocket ship. You have to book a flight with NASA. It's like, okay, you see, everyone keeps coming back to the same group. It's always the same group. It's always NASA. Feels like, no, there's other space agencies out there. It's like, well, no, because NASA was first, and they were the ones that built the architecture. And all these other space agencies, JAXA, the European Space Agency, the Chinese, the Russians, they all report to the same people. And I know I go off on rants, but that's where it really starts getting interesting.
It's wonderful that you go off on a rant. How often do you get a chance to do that with this sort of subject?
Not that often, believe it or not.
All right, then. Well, fascinating, because there are so many people who have done studies, and the bubbles coming out of the space helmet, things that just don't add up. It's over the top. And the cloud structures. There's so many different things that we've seen and that you've brought forward. If I had not seen the 200 proofs, I don't think that I would really have been convinced yet. But it was all in one great package for me. And that led me to the answer of the question of, please, God, explain to me why you're saying there's four corners of the earth. And that was his answer.
The 200 proofs, which was when I did the Flat Earth clues, and then Rob Skiba comes in and he starts looking at it from a scriptural point of view, because the religious sector, and I did a whole clue based on it, because organized religion has a real stake in this, because it gives them a huge amount of leverage against mainstream science, because everything will break down if we are in, and if, for those of you, and I know I'm kind of jumping around a little bit, don't know exactly what we're talking about. What we're basically talking about is a Truman Show type environment, old school Genesis firmament, where, you know, a barrier that separates the waters below and the waters above, which is basically that the earth is not a sphere in any way, shape, or form. It is a flat, enclosed structure with the stars and the sun and the moon very, very close, that are inside, no different than a planetarium. And to do that, you know, you have to, unfortunately, you're going to have to give up everything that you've been taught up until this point, everything about solar systems, galaxies, and how the sun works and how the moon works. It's all wrong. It all was wrong to begin with. And what they were, and I believe the secret societies knew for the longest time, but they couldn't prove it until you had the technology to actually go out and test the barrier itself, meaning go out to Antarctica or go up high enough to see if there was a firmament. You're not going to know anything, which meant until the internal combustion engine was developed in the early 1900s, you didn't even have the ability to do anything, to go to any altitude or really go against the elements. So when they figured it out, and basically the premise of everything I've done is, when they figured it out back in about 1956, the nations, the top nations that survived World War II, meaning the Soviet Union and the United States, they basically became an alliance, a secret alliance that said, you know what, ruling the world is one thing, but we cannot let this thing get out. We basically wouldn't, you know, they were wrong about, you know, the global model was wrong, but they weren't going to tell the population, because it would have been, they thought there would have been a lot of chaos, and they wouldn't be able to, you know, a huge paradigm shift, and a huge spiritual shift, and they didn't want to do it. And I know that I was a little bold in one of my clues when I called it, you know, they are hiding God. But
I think it's true, though.
Yeah.
Only because,
really, when you boil it down, it really does point to that. And that is, if you had proof of intelligent design, and I'm not necessarily saying the handprint of God on a wall, but if you had something like that, wouldn't the public have a right to know? And I, you know, that sounds silly. It's like, well, there you go. The people have a right to know. Well, no, actually, the people do have a right to know this, because everybody entertains the thought, and that is, where are we? Why am I here? What is the meaning of life? And this goes a long way to start answering those questions. And they decide to cover it up and says, you know what? This is our secret. It's not yours, and we're going to hold on to it for as long as we can. And here we are in 2016, and it's starting to break down.
Yes, and it's wonderful, because what was being hidden might have been land. It might have started with Elizabeth back in, you know, the Renaissance times. And it was held because there are those that like to control. That is who it is. Those who just prefer to control and want to have some reason to laugh at you because it makes them feel okay. And it's very sad that they don't have something of their own. But to keep everyone from a truth, We can also boil down to the fact that this planisphere is the same that you would find in Midgard with the Norse legends. You can see the same thing in India, all over the world. 500 years ago, everyone knew the Earth was flat. And it wasn't until it was forced on the people that it was something other than, probably because there was a vested interest of some sort. And we see that with Admiral Byrd's interview. And it leads to many more questions, but the wonderful thing is, that people have the opportunity to say, hey, wait a minute, I can expand my mind right now. I can expand to think that there's something greater and that I have a special place that is made specially for me, and maybe I am important. Maybe I can do something to help my neighbor instead of take them for all they're worth. You know, we have a different perspective from a lot of different people around the world suddenly waking up.
Yeah. The shift that would happen internally, because I still get, you know, and I know I shouldn't be harsh on people, because I get at least once or twice a week, I'll get an email from somebody that says, or a phone call, or says, you know, what does it matter? Why would it really matter if the Earth was round or if it was flat? And I was going, well, that's just confusing, because it's like, I still have to go to my crappy job in the morning, and it's like, yeah, but for how much longer, you don't know, because that job and everything in your life would change in a hurry because of what would happen. And that is, look, if all of a sudden people were told by mainstream media that, oh yeah, by the way, you're living in a giant building, you know, and all the stars and the sun and the moon, everything is just a backdrop, there would be three big things that would happen. One would be education. That would happen overnight, and that is every college. There's a lot of colleges in this world, and every college immediately, your astrophysics and astronomy departments, those things would shut down, just shut down. They would never reopen. But all the remaining physical sciences, and by that I mean, you know, geology, hydrology, archaeology, biology, take your pick, all of them would have to be retooled for this new model. The education system would be in a huge state of flux. New scientists would have to come out of the woodwork to try to deal with this new paradigm shift. The second thing would happen would be economic, which is what happens is. Hang on, I just completely lost my train of thought.
Well, economically, how many people printed out globes on all their stationery?
Yeah, yeah. Well, not just that. Think of all the militaries in the world. Because all the militaries in the world, which were initially keyed up to fight each other, what happens to those militaries? What do they do? You know, are you really going to go to war? Because we're all become, you know, one big community. So, rival nations, blood feuds, are these things really gonna still exist? That's the second part. But there's also the side note to that would be the religious aspect of it. Meaning, and it's every religion in the world, the big five are, Hinduism, Buddhism, Judaism, Islam, and Christianity. They've all been looking for proof of intelligent design. You know, they've all been looking for the Holy Grail, the Ark of the Covenant. They've been doing this forever. Everyone wants the secret, the sacred artifact. If they all got this at the same time, what happens then? You know, you're giving them all a proof of God at the same time, and that they represent 80% of the population in this world. They would turn on science and say, by the way, you were wrong about a lot of things, and we turned out that we were right about a lot of things. What else have you been wrong about, and what else are we right about? They become way, way more powerful than they ever were before. Now, I'm not saying they're gonna walk through universities and start burning buildings down, but there will be some harsh feelings out there, because it's like, okay, who actually knew about this lie, there's going to be some accountability, not to mention the biggest class action lawsuit of all time, which would be NASA. And all their subcontractors and all their subcontractors, it would be billions, if not trillions, of dollars, which would be amazing. But the positive aspect of this, I do believe, but it's like, why would I care if the Earth was round or flat, is that if it becomes flat, which means it becomes enclosed, which means it becomes, it was built. That's the key here. Mm-hmm. If it was built and you have proof it was built, that means there's a creator. If there's a creator, that means there's probably been somebody looking over your shoulder for a while now.
Yeah.
And now, beforehand, it was like, oh, no, I can kind of get away with it. You know, everyone's got that whole, you know, devil and angel on their shoulder story. But I try to give people the stoplight argument. And that is, everybody's run a stoplight until they start installing stoplight cameras. And then you don't run that stoplight anymore. It's like, well, not, why not? It's, well, because I'll get caught. The picture will be taken of me. It's like, well, then why were you thinking about running it in the first place?
Mm-hmm.
That's what things change. And that is, people won't do the things that they would normally do, I believe, because, they, you know, it's like, well, you're accountable. At that point, you become truly accountable for your actions.
Mm-hmm.
Now, of course, there's going to be psychopaths out there. They're going to do things no matter what. They don't care. But most of us, you know, who have been on the fence for all these years, we're going to look over our shoulder, literally, and go, all right, I get it. I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to steal this. I'm not going to, you know, I'm not going to do this bad thing or this bad thing. In fact, would you do anything malicious towards anybody? Would you actually, you know, kick somebody when they're down? Would you, you know, spread lies? You know, the argument is that Santa Claus, the naughty and nice list doesn't mean anything. You know, it's pointless, right? Until you see Santa Claus sitting there in your living room eating cookies. Then the list makes a whole lot more sense, and then you got to be good. I mean, you don't have to be good, but you're going to be rolling the dice, and I don't think a lot of people are going to do it, because I've driven around a lot of different places with those stoplight cameras. I don't see people blowing those things, you know, glam. That's the big, you know, the big push is why I'm trying to keep this this thing as positive as possible compared to all the other sinister conspiracies out there. This one, I think, more than anything, has the chance to change the world in a really great way.
I do too. I think many people are going to step up and say, you know, everyone deserves a chance, yes, but bullies need to be brought under control before they're given chances again. Because this has been our problem. We have a bully world, we've allowed it, and now we see the result of it, and it's been going on for too long, and this is emancipation.
Yeah.
I love it.
It's potentially a new golden age if it is done right.
It is.
You probably, if you saw the clues, I asked the powers to be. I said, look, you could do this. You guys could be the heroes and turn this into something great. You could make our civilization something worth caring about. And, I know people say, no, you're naive. They're never going to do it. You know, they're gonna go down the dark path and turn it into something horrible. I was like, well, at least my conscience is clear. At least I warned them.
Well, that's the whole thing. If you're standing on the wall and you see the army coming, you don't sit there and go, well, look at the pretty lights, and not tell anyone that it's going on. Yes, and it's so exciting. It's so wonderful, and it's laughable. It's wonderful. I just see so much potential. What are some of your favorite situations, favorite moments in discovery when you realized about the...
The big one for me was the cleverness of it, meaning when I was looking at it, you know, because I tried, everyone's heard this story, you know, I tried to debunk this thing for 9 months, starting in the summer of 2014, because I didn't believe it. There's no way. No one believes it the first time, and I'm not kidding when I tell people, I say that if you don't laugh at this thing, if you don't roll your eyes or try to ridicule it or just go, oh my God, this is the most horrible, insane thing ever, then if you don't do that the first time you see it, then there's probably something wrong with you, because that's the conditioning that everybody has, and mm-hmm. Including me. So when I was looking at it, I started, as I was starting to kind of unfold things and try to figure out the subtle nuances of it, I realized that it was so cleverly done, not just from the powers that be, you know, I'll give them some credit because, you know, they've hid it for the last 60 years, but most of the work was done for them. Let's be honest here. You know, the whole place was designed so that we did not know that it was enclosed. You know, the globe hints here and there were put in artificially so that we wouldn't, you know, so we wouldn't know that we were kind of encased in this thing. So one of my favorite moments that I had was when I was looking at the just a breakdown, when I was looking at like the oceans, for example, and most people don't realize that the oceans are only 3% salt. You know, it's not that much by comparison to freshwater. But what that does is 3% is just enough that that human beings can't drink it, which means it restricts traveling by ships, you know, back in the old days when they were exploring, because the limits of how you could explore by ship was really limited to your fresh water,
yes,
more than anything. So because you couldn't drink the water that you were sailing on, you were severely limited, and lots of missions failed because of it. Either they had to turn back, or they died, or whatever.
There was no sailing solution.
No.
Yeah. For the problem.
So they didn't know what to do, and so I was going, that is a great, I mean, imagine that little thing, that and the, you know, the mm-hmm. subtle negative reinforcements out at the outer edge, meaning, you know, because people say, well, if it's an edge, you know, you're going to fall off, and the Earth is flat, mm-hmm. it's going to fall off. Like, no, mm-hmm. because there's an entire edge made out of ice.
Too cold.
It starts out at 200 feet high and then goes up to 2 miles high, and then there's no animal life, plant life, or anything out there. There's no way you can cross it because you don't have the supplies to go across it.
Mm-hmm.
But how that negative reinforcement is so subtle to where, you know, when you get close to Antarctica, how it gets colder and colder, and then you get icebergs at about 15 degrees. And then if you actually made it to the beachhead, it's just another layer and another layer. But the whole point is that you were the ones that makes the decision to turn back on your own. And I thought that was great because it makes it seem like it's your choice. And it's not your choice. It's just the layers of reinforcement, like with a pet, are put there, but it doesn't make it, whoever built this place, it doesn't make them seem heavy-handed. It's like, oh, yeah, fine, let them go out there. You know how we do with children sometimes. Well, let them put the penny in the light socket, see what happens. And that's what,
build your Tower of Babel. There's a Van Allen belt.
Oh, yeah. Oh, don't. That's a Van Allen belt. That's a fun one as well. That's just one of the questions I throw out to people, and that is, you know, the Van Allen belt, which was, you know, announced in 1959 by NASA. You know, they were the ones that literally said, oh, yeah, by the way, this is up there, this horrible band of radiation. You never can go through it. Don't ever try.
Mm-hmm.
And then 10 years later, they're going through it.
Yep.
But they didn't say how they got through it.
Uh-huh.
It's like, what shielding did you use? Because there's only two common elements you can use to go through the Van Allen belt with. One is lead, you know, that's super cheap. Then there's gold, which is very expensive, but, you know, you can afford it if you're NASA. You could use maybe a barium alloy or something like that, but that's super, super hard to find. But the point is they never said what they used. They just went through it on these round trips during Apollo 8, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, and nobody talked about it. And it was just mind-boggling to me because, and I would have thought, okay, well, people said, well, it's classified, you know, it's a super secret shielding. I was going, yeah, that's fine and all. But then in October of 2014, NASA released this video called Orion Trial by Fire, where they come out, and they release this on not only the internet, but on television.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this little 7-minute thing where they come on, they say, oh, yeah, this Orion project, we're going to go to Mars, we're going to send an unmanned capsule through the Van Allen belt because we haven't figured out how to solve the radiation problem.
By the way, yes,
Like, we haven't solved it. You solved it in the 60s. What's left to solve?
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, and I was just going ballistic. I could not believe some producer was dumb enough to make that thing. And then, of course, you know, less than, 3 weeks ago, they closed down the Orion program entirely. You know, they were first like, oh, yeah, we're going to send people to Mars. And then in December, they said, oh, yeah, there's this French science module we were waiting for, and it's not going to be ready in time, so we're just going to scrap the entire Mars program. why would you scrap the entire program? It's a French part. It's a French science thing. Who cares about the French? Not knocking the French. I know some very nice French people. But who cares about them when it comes to this mission? And they said, oh, yeah, it's postponed indefinitely. And so now it's like they're not even going to talk about it again until, like, 2018. Basically, there's case. Nothing's going to happen. They're never going to Mars.
They're implying maybe that the Van Allen belt is further away than the moon was.
Well, the Van Allen belt, if you believe what they say starts at, I don't know, 400 miles up or 400 kilometers and extends to tens of thousands of kilometers. It's very, it's supposedly very thick and very deadly. Mm-hmm. But when you ask their explanation, you know, because they, of course, they did have to explain to people back in the 60s how they got through it. And they said, well, we just went real fast. You know, we just floored it. That was the answer. We're just going to go real, real fast. Therefore, there will be limited amount of exposure to the bad melon belts as you're trying to get to the moon, which is great and all, except there's a problem there. And that is fine. Let's say you did. I don't believe it, but let's say you did go real, real fast and went through it. Well, that's just the one-way part. What happens when you're in the 60s? How they got through it. And they said, well, we just went real fast. You know, we just floored it. That was the answer. We're just going to go real, real fast. Therefore, there will be limited amount of exposure to the bad melon belts as you're trying to get to the moon, which is great and all, except there's a problem there. And that is fine. Let's say you did. I don't believe it, but let's say you did go real, real fast and went through it. Well, that's just the one-way part. What happens when you're heading back to Earth? Because that whole real, real fast thing, that's not there anymore because you don't have the rocket technology anymore because you're just kind of limping back. Plus, you can't go real, real fast if you're trying to get home because you got to hit the brakes, which means you're actually going to do the opposite. You're going to go real, real slow, which means you're going to be hanging out in the belt for a long time as you're trying to get back into Earth's atmosphere, if you believe that. And I absolutely do not. What I'm saying, for those people who are listening and aren't quite getting some of the broader strokes, and I'm saying that the entire inception of NASA, when it was founded in 1958, up until the present day, what you're listening right now, is that it was completely fabricated to hide the world from what you know. That they found out it was a globe in the 50s, the early 50s, and they had to militarize space, and they didn't want to hide. You know, they didn't want to tell you. It became a weird kind of Twilight Zone episode where, you know, it's a great plot twist where they get up there and it's like, oh, man, this is not good at all. The decision has to come pretty quick. Should we tell people? Should we tell the general population? And they said, you know what? It's going to be a mess. Let's just deal with it. You know, we'll hide it as long as we can. We'll have enough contingency plans. And then if we have to tell them later, we're going to make sure we're fully prepared for complete economic collapse if that happens, which I don't think it would. But, you know, they're not going to take chances.
Well, it certainly is an amazing event.
Yeah.
It's a world event, and we're not really sure when things are going to pop large, because this could cause a problem with announcing aliens coming to save us.
Well, or is it the precursor to it? What I try to tell people is, anyone that's been doing the flat earth thing long enough know my opinion on something, which is, this thing could have been repressed very, very easily. In 2015, Flat Earth was not what I thought I would be doing, nor did I want to do it. But for whatever reason, I was compelled to do it. And I was not stopped in any way, shape, or form, nor was anybody else in the Flat Earth movement. It just grew in a real, organic, viral sense through social media. You know, mainstream has just avoided it like the plague. Neil deGrasse Tyson has come on national television and said on air, on CNN and Bloomberg, say, look, we do not, the media should not be talking about Flat Earth. Why would you do that? But to your point, if you wanted to announce some sort of alien agenda, that would be a good starting point. And that is, you lead in with Flat Earth, mess with people's head anyway, as far as reality goes, and what's real and what's not, and what they've been told, and then, they're vulnerable. So at that point, you could have aliens show up and say, oh yeah, by the way, we built it. And who's gonna doubt them? Well, the religious right, would, and different spiritual groups probably wouldn't buy it, depending on what they looked like. So yeah, that's kind of what people are, that's the buzz in the flat earth world right now, is everyone saying, okay, it's a setup for something bigger. It's being allowed to permeate through social media. So what is the follow up if flat earth is kind of like the jabs in boxing? What's the big right hook? That's what we're looking for right now.
The third right hook. I don't know. And the map, the insignia for the UN is certainly obvious in so many movies. What was the last apocalypse movie with the X-Men? I can't tell you how many places I could see references to where we live. Not just maps, but also arcs and different things and flatness underneath. It's amazing. It's all over the place. And it's being thrown in people's faces, and if that's their only joke, the joke's almost over. Everyone's about to get it.
Yeah.
And that's good.
Yeah, that's absolutely right. And I forgot to tell people, you touched on a point there, what the map actually looks like. So a lot of people can't envision it. It's like, well, how are the continents laid out? You want to see it, just look at the UN flag. That's easy to find. You know, just type it in Google. And that is the UN flag, which was designed in 1946, shows the North Pole at the center of the map, and the continents kind of spread organically outward, and then the outer edge. Normally, on a globe, would all end in Antarctica. So Antarctica would actually be stretched around the outer edge like a giant ice wall. Now, up until now, people said that was really just a map projection, and it's not really literal. It's not that Antarctica is stretched around, it's like a giant ice wall. But in reality, what we're saying is that that's exactly the case. Although it is interesting that the UN map, Antarctica is missing. You know, why is Antarctica a giant continent? Why is it not on the UN map? Why not include it at some point? It's like, well, no, that's just the way you'd have to draw it. It's like, no, you could have drawn it exactly like the AE projection. The AE projection was 1,000 years old, way older than the UN flag. All you do is copy it exactly. But they seemed like they wanted to keep it, this kind of this inside joke. And in fact, in 1946, I don't think even they knew for sure. I think they jumped the gun because Admiral Byrd, our United States' greatest explorer and youngest naval admiral, he was down there looking from 1928 until his death in 1957, and looking for this thing, and even then they weren't sure what was going on, where the borders were and how everything was laid out, and it looked like they were almost ready to give up in 1954, and then of course by 1955 Murphy's Law kicks in and they figure it out for sure.
There is a term, Arctic Circle. It's in our vocabulary, and it's all right in front of us, and that's part of the laughing at those who do not see and who's easily manipulatable and who's too smart for their own good.
And I don't think, there's a lot of people that will come back and say, because one of the arguments is, well, there's too many people that have to know about it. Like everybody in NASA, every NASA employee and all these governments, like, no.
No, they wouldn't.
You wouldn't have to let that many people know. It's not like the Manhattan Project where you had to, swear all these people that were working on atomic weapons, to secrecy. This is one of those things where, anyone that's turning a wrench, they don't have to know anything.
Right.
People that, that run security, people that, basically, unless you're at the highest levels of government or super rich, and they say, well, Bill Gates knows. No, why would you tell Bill Gates? Why would you tell any of those guys? These are, we're talking about the highest of the high would have to know this. Because really, in this case, less is more. The less people that know about this, the less people you have to worry about killing and keeping under wraps, because you cannot let this thing leak out. Now, luckily, the mainstream media is completely controlled by the authority, so they don't have to worry about it very much. So they're not going to run the story. If it breaks out in the mainstream media, and you know this as well as anybody, that means they want the story to come out. The question is why. And that's what we're waiting for now.
How many people have a vested interest in their lives and their brains and their time and their energy on work that they are just about to realize means nothing based on those equations? That is a very frightening thing for people who are so ingrained in certain parts of the educational world. And what most people do not understand is that schools and colleges were built originally for people to learn to read the Bible, which was, it's actually, if you look at it from a game standpoint, if we're in a video game, then this is the rule book. And someone built the game. They started with the light and the dark and laid it all out and made a biosphere and windows so that the watchers can see what's going on and people can watch the game. And if we just have a virus in it, and that could be easy to take care of by going, hey, wait a minute, things are really not so bad. Like, we can change it in the twinkling of an eye. you know, we can all get together and be the people we were meant to be rather than what we've been forced to be. Ignorant.
Agreed. So agree.
Well, is there a particular thing that you find is interesting in what are some of your favorite CGIs or favorite photos?
Well, the thing was that the one that you know everybody knows about, and again, if you want to look it up, I got a good CGI story for you. I got several actually. The first one was, and a lot of people know this one already, which was because again, I saw this back in 2000, and it was literally right in front of my face, and I completely missed it. Like everybody, because why would anyone ever believe it? That was, I was looking for, back in 2000, I was looking for images of Earth that I could put on all the tech support machines at a company I was working for in Boulder, Colorado. And so I was doing searches, you know, on the internet. I was looking for, you know, pictures of the Earth from space, and you know, I knew Boolean strings pretty well, that I could find stuff, and I got a lot better as time went on. But back then, I was just typing all the stuff, and I just kept getting... Every search I put in, I kept getting the same image. And I don't mean variations of the same image of Earth. I mean the exact same picture of Earth in just different resolutions. Meaning, and everybody knows which one I'm talking about. It's the one from Apollo 17 from 1972, showing the bottom part of Africa and all of Antarctica, and mostly clouds. And I thought, and no matter what I searched for, I kept getting that image. And it was driving me nuts because it was impossible. Mm-hmm. I was going, you know, I knew anything. I was like, look, NASA should have tens of thousands of images on the internet. They should be, you know, their website. I'm literally yelling at the screen. I'm going, you suck, NASA. You guys are terrible at this. And so, I ended up picking another image and going with something completely different. Fast forward to when the iPhone first came out, and most people don't know this, but you can look it up. And that was the first globe, you know, the first iPhones had that globe image on it, you know, that iconic globe image. Well, that was created by a collaboration between NASA and one of the guys at Apple, because he couldn't find any pictures either of the Earth from space. And so he ended up fabricating one, you know, with the help of NASA, and just drawing the whole thing with CGI. And it's like, wait, why would you have to do that? There should be tons of pictures. That's, and then, you know, that's where, you know, a lot of this stuff goes. In fact, I've got a debate tonight where you're going to come out, and you know, that's one of my opening lines is, what happened to all the pictures of the Earth from space? Literally, from 1972 until July of 2015, there was one shot. Not four, not three, one. There should have been thousands. So many that you would have, you would just probably take, you know, the first 100 and sort through those and be like, okay, I'll pick this one. No, there was exactly one shot. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden they released a new blue marble shot, and NASA announced it. The White House tweeted it. Neil deGrasse Tyson talked about it. And it bugged me because they not only did they release, and they talked about it on CNN. You know, they talked about it on national news. They said, oh, yeah, by the way, this is the first blue marble shot we've done in 43 years. Well, why would you tell people that? Why
red
not?
Flag.
But they had to. They had to, one, they had to release the photo because we were driving them nuts. And by that, and yes, I know it's egotistical for the movement to actually say that.
Actually, it's true.
They've been making moves based on what we've been complaining about, basically.
Yeah.
The second one was the moon transiting in front of the Earth from a satellite that apparently nobody knew about. It was exactly 1 million miles away, and it was like six frames. It was like, you know, chunk, chunk, chunk. It was, South Park could have done, the animated team from South Park could have done a better job with the moon going in front of the in front of the Earth, which was horrible. And they still to this, and there was other little things like the Matt Boylan thing where he analyzed it. He has a good eye because he was a painter professionally, where he analyzed the Galileo footage from 1990, which was really supposedly the only footage that we had. It wasn't even a motion picture, but it was as close as we had to it, of the Earth rotating on its axis. And he goes, wait, this thing just did a 24-hour rotation and the weather didn't change. Basically, this, you know, the Earth turned the entire, you know, 360 degrees, and that you look at, it's the same cloud formation over the top part. It's like, well, how, that's not even possible. But then we had one of our guys call up, and there's a video online. He pretends to be a Hollywood producer. He calls up the NASA trademark office, puts the whole thing on speakerphone, records it, and basically asks them if they have any stock footage of the Earth rotating on its axis they could use for his movie. And he says, no, we don't have any of that. Which meant they disavowed the 1990 Galileo footage. So now they've got, so instead of thousands of hours of the Earth, taken from all angles, rotating here and there, they've gotten, instead of tens and tens of, unlimited, let's say 100,000 photos of the Earth from space, they've got two. And it just goes on and on to where, to now, of course, they're releasing stories every single day. I used to joke that it was like once a month. It was like clockwork. Releasing like a drum beat, once a month. Then it was once a week. Now it's literally every day. But the news they've been releasing as of late has been really, really horrible. To the point where they, canceled the Mars program. And then, 4 days ago, you may have even heard this, they canceled the ISS program.
Yes.
They're gonna shut it down. They're going to shut down the International Space Station. It's like, well, what? There's nothing left to shut down, guys. What else are you doing?
Yes.
If you didn't have the Mars program or the International Space Station, what else is the $20 billion for? And, sorry, I get worked up.
What did you do with all that money? Yes. Yeah. And now, you were interested in NASA very much when you were young. Did you ever play Orbiter? Did you ever play with that?
The video game Orbiter?
The simulator, the space simulation that's free on the web, and you go and you fly around the space station and all sorts of goodies?
I did not, but that didn't surprise me.
Oh, I really enjoyed that.
Wow.
But, it's part of the CGI. And one of the things that I find interesting that isn't brought up as much, but I think is an interesting question, in all the pictures that you see of, here is the Earth turning, and we can see the lights, and oh, look, it's beautiful, and you can see the curve of the Earth, and where are all the satellites?
Yeah.
Yes, that's a big one for me.
The satellites thing is a huge question, and that is, one, there's no clear consensus of how many satellites are up there. There's anywhere from supposedly 3,000 to 20,000, and that is not an exaggeration. But when you see the mapping, the computer mapping of exactly where these satellites are, this planet, if you believe in planets, should be just bristling with these shiny objects. And yet, when you see, time-lapse from the International Space Station, you don't see a glimpse of anything. You don't see anything flying by, either above or below, anything being taken from space. I mean, you should see, because these are all made out of highly reflective material, you should see satellites all over the place. Why aren't satellites taking pictures of each other? They're not. Look up, go on Google and look up satellites, satellite pictures of satellites, not just satellite pictures of actual satellites. You won't. You'll see artist renderings most of the time, computer animations, to the point where, because people have said, and I wasn't even on that when I made the clues, I said, I didn't even touch satellites, and people said after a while, what do you think of satellites? Now I say, I don't think there's satellites at all. I don't think there's anything up there, because the satellites have to go through, all the flight paths have to go through one organization, and the bigger one, the easier one for people to get their head around is, I said, look, if I can't trust the interior footage to the people that are floating around supposedly inside the International Space Station in their khakis and their polo shirts and their socks, why they don't wear shoes, I have no freaking idea. I can't trust that. If they're not allowed to go up that high, if they have to fake the interior footage of the ISS, then what faith do I have in anything that's really above spy planes? I mean, yeah, we can send weather balloons up to 120,000, 130,000 feet. Everything above that, though, that's NASA. Every image that comes that happens above that is NASA, and we're not getting anything from them that's legit. I mean, look up ISS hoax on the internet. The problem is this. I can boil it down for some people, because some people just still aren't getting it. The problem is that the detection capability of the internet, and I mean the internet hive minds, and I, by that I mean a lot of bored nerds out there,
amazing,
have now set their focus on real life events. Beforehand, it was just movies. Anyone has any doubts, go to moviemistakes.com or the 20 or 50 other sites that all they do is all nerds. They just pick on movie production because no matter how much money you spend on a movie, you're going to make production mistakes because movies are shot out of order.
Right.
So they're not shot chronologically. They're shot for cost effectiveness.
Not continuity.
And so if a coffee cup moves from one side of the room to the other in a single frame or scene and the actor doesn't do it, they're going to find it.
Yes.
And the problem was is that all of a sudden they started doing it to every movie and every television show, but then they started doing it to, like, real-life events, real-life things, which shouldn't, you know, it's like, well, it's real life. It's not like anything's going to be weird there because it's real life. It's like trying to find mistakes in the news, right? There's no mistakes in the news. That's real. It's all the truth. But then they started finding mistakes. And when it came to stuff like space station footage, they started finding lots of little production mistakes that should not be there. Mm-hmm. And you only have to find one or two before you start, you know, and then it starts snowballing. Then people start looking at everything and overanalyzing stuff. But there's a lot of interesting out of NASA to where you've got to wonder what they're spending the money on, because some of the stuff is rookie mistakes. You don't think they're there.
That's the whole thing, is that there are a lot of things happening out there that people don't realize are not real. They're staged events to try to get people swayed in one direction or another. And since they've gotten away with it this long, then let's try some other things.
Yeah.
And this is where the can of worms, it's only the beginning. What do you see as what's going to happen that can open up even more things in the direction of expansiveness in far as people's minds are concerned or relationships to their lives?
Well, with this, we've still got a ways to go, but here's what's been happening so far. We started out with, you know, just putting a lot of questions out there, you know, the big questions to science, mm-hmm. saying, you know, can you answer this? You know, tell us about the Earth from space. Tell us about why there are no movies. Tell us about why there's lack. There should be mountains of evidence on the scientific side that aren't there.
Mm-hmm.
And we put the question out there, and we thought for sure somebody would just stomp on it. But unfortunately, they haven't. And so, in fact, the opposite started happening, because when I started asking for whistleblowers, I started getting professionals, both from the military sector and the private sector, that have come forward and started talking and saying, look, everything that we see with our instruments confirms what you see, and that is the big three things. One is that the Earth apparently has no curve to it whatsoever that anyone can even detect right now, and it should be there. Two, that it's not spinning at all, and there's no instrument out there that's actually showing that it's spinning. And three, that the maps, you know, the big global map appears to be very, very wrong, especially in the southern hemisphere, which would make sense because anything outside of the equator, or in this case, you know, below the equator, depending on which model you're looking at, would be greatly exaggerated, greatly stretched out. So once the professionals started coming forward, it really started silencing people, and this thing started taking on legs of its own, which was really, really great. And then people started doing their own experiments, and now what we're doing, we're kind of waiting for, is what I wasn't kidding when I said this. Some people thought I was joking, and that was waiting for people to kind of come out of the closet on this. And I'm not trying to equate this with homosexuality in any way, shape, or form, but the comparisons are strikingly similar, which is there's a lot of people out there that are into Flat Earth, but they don't know who they can talk to about it.
Exactly.
Because it's so insane that it's like, it's not like you can go to a party. Now, I've, of course, heard of people that have gone to parties and say, oh, yeah, you know, they get drunk. It's like, oh, yeah, Flat Earth, that's a great thing, and they just get shot full of holes. But there's, you know, there's going to be some celebrities in one way or the other, be it, you know, actors, you know, musicians, or politicians, or somebody from the artistic community, somebody with a lot of followers, a lot of tweets, and that's what I'm kind of waiting for next. In fact, What's Her Face just came out the last couple of days. A perfect example, Tia Tequila. And she's like, she's totally on this. She's putting herself out there already. And for a lot of people, it's like being the first person on the dance floor. Nobody wants to be the first person on the dance floor, especially at a wedding. But once the first couple people get out there, people are like, oh, yeah, I love this song. You know, and then it doesn't take much to do. And that's what what we're kind of waiting for is for celebrities to even come forward and talk, even to make fun of it, you know, kind of do it in a sort of like a half-joking manner, even if they're trying to test the water. It's like, oh, this flat earth is ridiculous. Who's with me? You know, one of those things. It's like, I'd love to see that with somebody that had, you know, 5-10 million followers, because they all of a sudden expose people to it. Because if you go in, the great thing about it now, especially with social media, is there's so much content out there.
Yes.
That if you type in, I'm not kidding when we started this, back in February of 2015, when you typed in flat earth, you know, no filters in YouTube, you maybe got 40, 50,000 hits, maybe, you know, as far as relevant search criteria things. When you type it in, like right now, as we're talking on the phone, mm-hmm. right now, you said the same thing, flat earth, it's around 2.4 million.
Yes.
And there is so many hours. And these aren't short videos either.
No, these are long ones.
Yeah, there's a lot to talk about. And so there's people are not shy about putting 2 hours in there. And, I mean, I've put, oh, God, a couple hundred hours in there. And it is a lot of stuff that you can absorb. And I keep getting the same emails over and over again. And that is, once they start, because it's so enticing, it's like you're trying to dig a hole. It's like a dog burying a bone in the backyard. Once you start digging, faster and faster, because you think you can get through it. It's like, well, if I spend another day on it, maybe, you know, another day, either maybe I'll disprove it or I'll find some more stuff. And people keep treating it like this brand new, shiny topic, like a conspiracy it's never been talked about before, which is, of course, the ultimate irony, because it's the oldest conspiracy there is. You know,
yes.
that because everybody knew it. 4,500 years, everybody knew the Earth was flat. It was only in the last 500 years that
yes.
we changed it.
Yes.
And now it appears to be changing back. And that's the kick. And that is that's what I'm trying to work on now, is trying to decipher the next moves on the chessboard, which are why now. Why are you opening this sucker up now? You know, what else is going to be tied to this? Because it feels like, it's almost like I can hear music coming over the hill. Something big is coming, and it is going to be really, really awesome. It's going to scare a lot of people, but it is going to be amazing when this thing comes out.
I know, and you know, it's always hard for pioneers, and imagine the people who knew about this for years. What a lonely world for them, because no one could really listen to them, and this is so obvious and real that it's hard to turn your head from it. And then you wonder, all right, there are men who are still running for their lives because they've been talking about it. There are some astronomers and other NASA folk who've also disappeared or died because they were about to tell something that someone didn't want them to tell. There's some sort of vested interest, and it's still out there. And there's a reason that... Now, see, I can look at it a different way, too. If God decided he wanted to put a lie on the entire world, do you think he can do it? Well, of course, he's God. So,
yeah.
This is what's happened, and it's always good because it's a German word, Gott, just got changed to God. It just means good. And so, it's going to be good if it's going... So, this deception... being exposed is wonderful, and people who have a vested interest, who are afraid they're going to lose everything in their lives, just change your perspective slightly and you'll see what good there is in it. I mean, just listening to you, being able to lay out the information so quickly, easily, and eruditely is enough proof in being able to get the answers quickly and understand, not just understand it, grok it, you know, really get it. I really appreciate being able to hear you talk about some of the things that you're most interested in and the important points. Is there anything else? Is there any fascinating event that stands out in your mind, or anything that you're expecting, or
well, again, it's going to be, you know, I'm not gonna lie and say that it's all gonna be roses and champagne, because it's not. You know, there's a chance here. You know, I put most of the fault of the problems of the world on men and the powers that be, and I would like to think that they would do the right thing and turn this into something wonderful. However, you know, don't take my word for it. I would like to see that, but the odds say that they're going to do the opposite and try to turn this into, you know, some sort of giant control mechanism. If that's the case, just be ready for it, because I think ultimately, in the end, the people are going to be the ones that are going to be able to change the tipping point.
Well, that's the point. That is the point, yes.
Yeah. If we go into it and stay positive and stay...
Well, I think that's one of the prophecies also, is that in the middle of the strife and confusion, the real, true world begins to take its form. And that's the safeguard of not listening to those that want to scare you all the time so that they can have a meal off of your emotions or something. We just turn our faces to, hey, wait a minute, this can be so much better. And it is up to us, because the psychopaths are never going to get it. They look like a bigger group than they actually are. They have lots of strong arm abilities. But once we understand who we actually are, then where's the problem? You know? And that's why you encourage me so much. And I really thank you so much for the work that you've been doing, for the encouragement of other people, for the enlightening of so many people's minds, and for being on the front running of this wonderful, explosive controversy.
Thank you.
It's a world changer.
I'm hoping, and 2016, I'm going to give it everything I got.
Well, good, and thank you so much for talking to us, and I want to get this out as soon as I possibly can. And thank you once again, and safe journeys and more expansiveness to you and yours.
Thank you very much for having me, and God bless.
God bless you as well. Bye-bye.